first thank Bonnie for the use of her projector. Bonnie's from the other garden club, but I knew she had a projector and she was able to bring it, set it up, and coordinate and get it Mac savvy. And this is Dr. Michael Singer, University of Hartford grad, Arizona grad. He's a professor of my alma mater, Go Cardinals, GLSP 2009. His research is in understanding biodiversity via adaption in ecological traits, organization of ecological communities, and evolutionary diversification. And the title of his tale will be Insect Drama in Your Garden. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you. So it's fun to be here. You might know that about a year ago, I gave a talk to the Connecticut Horticultural Society, basically the same talk, and they seem to enjoy it, so hopefully you'll get something out of it as well. So really the goal, aside from all of the things that Elizabeth said, that are the subjects of my research, I'm also trained as an entomologist, and so I study insects, and so I want to give you some perhaps greater appreciation for insects than you might currently have as a gardener. Admittedly, there are...
You shouldn't squash it?
Well, it depends. Really, all I want you to do is to, before you just see it and squash it, to think a little bit about what it is, what it might be doing, because sometimes there can be beneficial insects in your garden and you don't want to squash those. So anyway, hopefully to make it a little more fun, I'll kind of organize this around various dramatic themes. And let me just grab this to... Oh, and the coffee's ready. That's good for everyone. And so one of the things that is dramatic about insects is just their diversity. So there are more kinds of insects than any other kind of macroscopic organism on the planet. There are over a million species of insects on planet Earth, and they're very diverse. This is just a little smattering of the diversity, some of the showier insects that you might see. But if you can see this chart, I'm not sure how well you can see that there's a very, yeah, if you need, if the lights might help you see things a little better. See how we can do that. Oh yeah? You can see it now. So this is a pie chart that shows different groups of insects and how much they contribute to overall diversity. And so beetles are the biggest chunk of the pie here. Lepidoptera, it's butterflies and moths. And flies are Diptera over here. And Hymenoptera are ants, bees, and wasps. And then there's a lot of other groups of insects. But these are the real big ones. And they're very diverse in terms of form. So when you really look closely at insects, you see a lot of just strange looking creatures. But if you're an entomologist like me, you think they're very interesting and often beautiful. And also just what they do for a living. They're really diverse. There's all kinds of different ecological niches that insects occupy and all kinds of roles they play in ecosystems. And in your garden, some of those things are really important to how your garden ecosystem functions, and in some cases they may be less happy things for you. And we'll get to that. But here's just a little kind of showing of garden insect diversity. This is from the University of Alberta, so some of these insects aren't the ones we would find right around here, but a lot of them are, and at least a lot of the close relatives of these insects are. So just even from this, it's hard to really focus on any one picture here, but you can just see that there's just a lot of diversity there. And it's kind of fun when you really look around for insects in your garden, and of course it'll be a good couple of months before we can do that. You know, there's just a lot to see. It's kind of like treasure hunting. So here's the insect drama. These are some of the themes that I'll talk about, and I got a kick out of this. I found that there was a BBC production from 1960 called The Insect Play.
Is that Laurence Olivier?
I'm not sure who that is, but it looks pretty funny. And so, you know, you can see all these kinds of, you know, the tragedy, the comedy, the sex, the violence, the costumes. You can see all of this stuff for real in your garden among the insects. So we'll start with tragedy because this is what you're probably most familiar with. These are the insects that eat your plants, including some of your prized crops and flowers and things like that. This is a tortoise beetle, and it's living on plants in the tomato and potato family and feeding on those plants. So you might have seen this if you tried to grow eggplant or tomatoes or something like that. Usually eggplant is the one that this gets on. And here's some eggplant leaves that are damaged by this. It's the clavate tortoise beetle. And you can see its droppings over here, always an unpleasant sight. And it causes this kind of damage, these little holes, kind of like buckshot or something in the leaves. And so, you know, insects like this, not so fun. Aphids, of course, you probably have seen aphids lots of times on your garden plants. I also want to point out that a lot of the pictures I'm going to be showing you were taken by my colleague at Wesleyan, Brian Stewart, who is actually in the physics department, but he is just an amateur entomologist and has taken it upon himself to photograph all the insects in his garden in Middletown. So a lot of the insect pictures I'll show you are in the area. They're local, more or less. So you might have found aphids on your roses. That's not so good. The thing about aphids is that they do some damage to plants just from their feeding. They suck on the phloem sap of plants, which you might know, and that's of course taking away all the good photosynthate that these plants are making as food for themselves, the carbohydrates. But the worst thing about aphids is that they transmit diseases like viruses, and that's because the way they feed, they plunge their mouth parts into the phloem sap, and if the viruses are in the insect, they are like a hypodermic needle, and they'll inject those into your plant. So that's usually the biggest, in terms of agriculture, that's the biggest problem that aphids pose. Of course, it's more obvious to see damage from things like caterpillars, because they chew the leaves, just like those tortoise beetles. And you can just visibly see your prized plants getting chewed up and disappearing before your eyes. And sometimes the caterpillars aren't so obvious as these, and you don't notice them, like those tomato hornworms. You don't see them until they're great big and they've already eaten half your tomato plant. So that's another thing, is once you get in the habit of looking for insects, it's not only sort of fun to find them, but the ones you don't want, you might find sooner because you're developing an eye, you know, kind of a search image to look for them. Here's just some comic relief here. This is the caterpillar of the eastern tiger swallowtail butterfly, which is not usually a pest at all. You might find it if you have a cherry tree or maybe some other trees that they'll feed on, but this caterpillar it's sort of humorous. It's kind of has a little face here. And this funny looking thing sticking out the top is an organ that it extrudes in response to being disturbed, and there's a kind of strange odor that gets emitted along with that. And this is known to be a defensive response of this caterpillar, so that creatures like ants or wasps or maybe even birds might get deterred by that. And here's another just kind of strange insect that looks like it's shooting fireworks out of its rear end or something. But these are just strands of wax, and various kinds of insects like white flies and scale insects have waxy coverings that prevent them from desiccating. And in some cases, they also might protect it from predators. But very strange costumes that insects have, and some of them are kind of humorous to look at. All right. Another important dramatic theme is sex. So you might see this in your garden too. Just be prepared. These are hoverflies, these little flies that they look sort of like bees, and you might see them and you might think they're bees, but actually they're pretty good to have in your garden. So you want these ones to be having sex and reproducing, because their larvae will actually eat aphids for a living. And so they're really good at taking care of the aphids in your yard. And here are some other flies that are mating. You'll see these ones quite a bit, these long-legged flies. Very metallic in coloration. And oftentimes they're just wandering around the surface of leaves. They're often moving very quickly, sometimes hard to see well enough so you could get a photograph like this. I'm sure Brian worked pretty hard on this one. That's always interesting. Here's a very acrobatic active copulation from some moths. These are from Arizona. This one, probably the male here is hanging on while the female is there coupled to him. So some strange sights sometimes that you find. But the more important kind of sex in your garden is going to be insects that are helping the plants have sex. So that's pollination. And so let's not forget the beneficial effects of insects, especially bees, but also insects like these hawk moths, in some cases flies and butterflies that will do pollination. And you know, some of the plants that you grow, if they're plants you want to reproduce, which you know you don't always want with garden plants, but sometimes you do, for them to produce fruits and seeds. And certainly with crop plants in agriculture, we want that. Insects are there and they're doing this vital service. And it's not just honeybees, which you might or might not know are not native to North America. It's lots and lots of different kinds of insects. And there are lots of other bees in particular that are quite good at pollination. Bumblebees, for example, are very important pollinators, and they have been on the decline, unfortunately, for the most part, in much of the Northeast, and a lot of other bees as well. So here's a little bee that you can see has collected a lot of pollen, and it's also probably drinking nectar from this daisy flower. And some bees are actively collecting pollen on special pollen combs on their legs because that's what they feed their offspring. And other bees don't collect as much of it. You know, honeybees are sort of variable, although they tend to collect quite a bit of pollen as well. But what these bees do is they'll accumulate the pollen. They'll usually make a little kind of ball out of it, and they bring it back. And somewhere, most of these bees are solitary. They don't live in a colony. And there's some burrow or maybe a little hole in a twig somewhere that they've made a nest. And they'll put that pollen ball in there, lay an egg, and the bee larva will consume that and grow into an adult bee. Violence in pursuit of sex. Well, yeah, sometimes you may come across a beetle like this, a stag beetle. It's a fairly large beetle, and it might seem kind of scary at first. But the males, as shown here, have these large mandibles or mouth parts that they use not to try to bite you, but to try to fight each other so that they can prove who's the bigger beetle to a female nearby. And so this is a pretty common phenomenon in certain kinds of insects, especially beetles, where there's some male competition to try to win the affections of female beetles. So occasionally we'll see this, you know, in your yard, or we see them on campus at Wesleyan sometimes in the summertime. Now, violence is actually a good theme to have in your garden because a lot of times it means that you're having some insects controlling the populations of other insects. And here's just one example of several I'll show where here's this long-legged fly. Remember, we saw this one mating earlier. But it has found a smaller fly, and it's eating that. So a lot of these insects are predators of other insects. You probably know that ladybird beetles or ladybugs are important predators of aphids. Here's one of them that was from Brian Stewart's garden. And here are these little aphids. And the adult beetles that look like this do some feeding on aphids, but it's really the larvae of ladybird beetles that are the most voracious predators. And they look somewhat different. I don't think I have a picture of that here. But they are usually black and orange, but they're very kind of spiny looking and longer. They're strange things, but it's worth looking them up and getting an eye for them so you don't mistake them for something that you want to kill, because those are really, really voracious predators of aphids. Very good to see in your garden. Here's another case of violence. This is a robber fly. Robber flies are kind of fun to watch because they capture other insects while those insects are flying. So they're aerial predators. They typically will perch on leaves or maybe a stem or maybe on a garden post or something, usually in an area where there's pretty good traffic, air traffic for insects like flies and bees and wasps, sometimes butterflies. And they just, they're expert flyers and they have expert vision. Look at the eyes on these things. They can really see almost 360 degrees all the way around. And they'll just snag an insect out of the air, bring it down to a perch, and then they have these piercing, sucking mouth parts, like a beak that they can pierce the prey with and kill it and eat it that way. So here are some other important predators that you might see in your garden. Ants, for one, are important predators of herbivores like caterpillars. So this is a picture of a carpenter ant. And you might know carpenter ants as ants that you don't want around your house because they could damage your wood, the frame of your house. But in fact, they do a lot of other things, including feeding on caterpillars that might be attacking your plants. Also, paper wasps, you might know them as something you don't really want around because they could sting you, or you get one of those nests on the house or something like that. But it's not a bad thing if you can, if there's a nest somewhere that's kind of out of the way, it's not a bad thing to have them, because they will, again, attack caterpillars and other insects that will damage your garden plants. So they're just performing pest control all the time. And what's going on here is this wasp has captured a caterpillar, and it is cutting it and getting rid of the gut material. So that's the plant material that caterpillar has been eating. And it's just going to take the rest of that caterpillar, turn it into a little ball, bring it back to the nest, and that's what the wasp larvae will eat. The adult wasps, like this one, really mainly feed on liquid food, like nectar or maybe some other things. And you'll see them sometimes going to flowers or drinking sap or something like that. So social insects like ants and wasps and bees, they have worker castes that feed the brood. And so that's what they're doing when they're collecting prey, like caterpillars. They're actually bringing that back to the nest. And the brood here are the ones that need that protein-rich food to grow and develop. The workers themselves really only need water and sugar, something to sustain their metabolism and their activity, but they're not growing at all, so they don't need protein-rich food. Another interesting kind of odd interaction that ants have in particular is sometimes they'll actually form mutualistic relationships with sap-feeding insects like aphids. So here these ants are tending these aphids right here. And this aphid is excreting a drop of what's called honeydew. Now, I mentioned before aphids feed on the phloem sap of plants. It's mainly sugar and water. But it does have low concentrations of amino acids, which they use to build proteins. And so they have to feed on a lot of phloem sap in order to get those amino acids, and they end up excreting, getting rid of as waste, a lot of sugar water. And that turns out to be a really good food for these worker ants. So what the worker ants do is they get food out of this interaction, and these aphids get protection. The ants will protect them from other enemies that might try to attack these aphids. And I'll show you some of those enemies later, parasitic insects that will try to attack the aphids. This picture here is showing something even more bizarre, and that is an ant that's drinking nectar from, in this case, it's an oak tree branch, but it's a very strange looking oak tree branch. It has been colonized by a tiny little wasp called a cynipid wasp, and it makes a gall, which is this kind of strange outgrowth of the plant tissue. The wasp lays eggs in the plant, and it releases chemicals into the plant that mimic the hormones of the plant, and it causes the plant to grow into this strange structure that's called a gall. And in this case, it's a very unusual gall, because it actually causes the plant tissue to develop these little nectaries, which, you know, normally you'd have nectaries on flowers, and some plants naturally have what are called extrafloral nectaries, nectaries on leaves or stems. And in this case, you might know that oak trees don't normally have flowers that make a lot of nectar. They have these, you know, catkins. But apparently, there's a way for the chemicals to induce this formation of nectaries, and that's what these ants are drinking from. They're drinking nectar from this. And again, they're protecting the gall, making insect inside, which will be subjected to parasitism from other wasps that will want to attack it. So some of these interactions are very kind of complex and strange, but ants are involved in some of these food for protection mutualisms. So here's these parasitic insects I'm telling you about, parasitoid wasps. They're important biological control agents because, unlike some of the predators I've told you about, they're often very host specific. So you might know that in agriculture, some of these parasitic wasps are used as very specific biological control agents to control certain insect pests on certain crops, and that's because of their host specificity. Here's one of them that's attacking an aphid. So it's laying an egg inside this aphid's body, and that egg will hatch and develop into a larval wasp that will feed on the aphid from the inside and eventually kill it. Here is a caterpillar that has been killed by a parasitic wasp. The wasp larva has fed on the caterpillar from the inside, has emerged, and has spun a cocoon here around the pupal case, and then this will eventually give way to an adult wasp that looks somewhat like this. Again, here's another one, a caterpillar that has been almost entirely, it's almost dead, but these caterpillars sometimes will live for a little while until these wasps emerge from these cocoons, and in some cases, they are zombies that do protection of the wasps' cocoons. Sometimes these caterpillars are nearly dead, but they will still flail about, and any predator that comes tries to disturb these cocoons because they've been totally brainwashed by their parasites. So some very strange kinds of host manipulations and things going on with these parasitic wasps. And there are many, many species of these. You almost certainly will have these in your garden, but many of them are so small that you wouldn't necessarily notice them. And you might not even be able to recognize them as wasps. Another group of these parasitoid insects are flies. So it's just another independent evolution of the same kind of lifestyle, but instead in the version of a fly. And oftentimes these flies, they're called tachinid flies. They're pretty bristly, and you know, to most people they look pretty ugly. Some of them can be fairly large, but if you see a fly like this in your garden, resist the urge to kill it, because it is probably going to kill some caterpillars that will eat your plants. So here's a case of a hornworm caterpillar that is eating this leaf, has eaten a lot of it, but here's a tachinid fly that's shown up and is, you can see this caterpillar is looking a little worried here. This fly is going to try to lay an egg on this caterpillar. And usually, it takes a while sometimes, because the flies usually have to lay eggs on a big caterpillar like this up near the head, in a place where the caterpillar can't turn around and bite off the egg. Sometimes you'll find these caterpillars with eggs just right behind the head or right on the head. And these flies, they usually can't lay eggs inside the host like the wasps often do, but they'll lay eggs on the outside, and a tiny little fly maggot will emerge and burrow into the host and feed on the inside and eventually grow and kill it and emerge. Sometimes it takes several days, maybe a little less than a week, for a fly like this. Whoops, I'll just continue on showing you. But for a fly like this, it would probably take a week to 10 days, sometimes a little longer, depending on how long the life cycle of the host is. But for those aphid parasitoids, you know, it's just a matter of maybe 5 days or something like that. And so here are some examples of caterpillars that have been attacked by these tachinid flies. This one has three pupae of the flies that have come out of it, and it's dead. Here's one that sadly has received some eggs on its head, and there are probably fly maggots inside it. Here's another case. These leaf-footed bugs, which are mating here, so the sex part here, but there's also violence, because if you look closely, you'll see that there's a tachinid fly egg here on the bugs, and so this is not looking good for these bugs. This is the fly that has laid those eggs. It's called Trichopoda, and it specializes on these leaf-footed bugs. And so if you see a weird-looking fly like this in your yard, you'll know that it's going after these leaf-footed bugs. And generally, it's good to have these guys around. Moving away from violence, it's one of my favorite themes, but only among insects. But costumes, so that's fun. Another thing about insects is that they you know, they have exoskeletons, so they can't just keep having their skin grow as they grow. Eventually, they outgrow their skin. And so here is a grasshopper that has outgrown its skin, and it's molted, and it's shed its old exoskeleton, and it has a new exoskeleton underneath. And so it's coming out of the old. And here's a caterpillar that's a pretty fancy one that has shed its old skin, has molted. And so they do a lot of costume changes during their lifetimes because of this growth process of molting. And another fun thing about the costumes is the camouflage you see. And sometimes you really can't see these insects at all. So these are caterpillars in each of these panels that I'm showing you. This is a caterpillar here. It's living on a manzanita plant in Arizona. And it looks just like the leaves, including this little necrotic tissue here. It's fake necrotic tissue. Very hard to see these caterpillars. Here's another caterpillar, also on manzanita. This time it matches the woody parts of the plant really well with all these little knobs and things like that. This is the head of the caterpillar. This is the tail end. And of course, these are important defenses that these caterpillars and other insects have against visual predators like birds. And that's been the source of natural selection that's caused the evolution of these incredible camouflage tactics and appearances that we've seen. And here's another fun thing with costumes, mimicry. So if you see this insect in your yard, you might think, oh, that's a bumblebee. But no, it's a robber fly that's mimicking a bumblebee. The way you can tell is that if you're an entomologist, you know that the head of a fly is pretty different than the head of a bee. So for example, the eyes, the size of the eyes on the head of this insect are much larger than what you'd see in a bee, and it's less kind of fuzzy around the face. Similarly, if you look closely, it's not always so easy to see this, but flies only have two wings, whereas bees and other flying insects have four wings. And so if you look closely, the antennae are also different. Bees tend to have more kind of fuzzy, typical antennae. Flies have these weird little knobs with a tiny little hair-like projection. But in any case, mimicry is pretty common. And here's another case. This is a very strange insect called a mantis fly. It's not very likely that you'd see a mantis fly, although occasionally they show up in gardens. I think Brian Stewart found one in his yard and has a picture. But this one's from Arizona, and it really looks a lot like a paper wasp. And these are predatory insects. They're kind of like praying mantises. They hang out on plants. They have raptorial forelegs, and they will grab and prey on insects that land nearby. And so they're often around flowers and parts of plants that have insects visiting them, bees, flies, wasps, butterflies. Very interesting. Here's another one, an ambush bug. You might see these on your flowers. They look like, I mean, they don't really look like a living thing. They just look like a piece of debris. But if you look closely, you'll see these little eyes and the antennae, and they also have these little raptorial forelegs. This is just hanging out, waiting for a bee or a fly or something to come along, and then it'll grab it and feed on it. So assassin bugs are another group that's very similar to this. And then there are some just fancy costumes, like this sharpshooter type of leafhopper. So it's an herbivore. It feeds on the xylem of plants, so also sucking the fluid from plants. And you'll see these around sometimes. They fly away pretty quickly, so they won't usually let you get too close. But at least, even though they're probably doing a little bit of damage to your plants, at least they're pretty. Here's a butterfly that has a false eye spot on the hind wing here. And it's another interesting aspect to the costumes of insects, false eye spots. You'll see this, some butterfly wings and some other kinds of insects have it. Generally, it's actually not that well studied, but it's thought to be a way to kind of fool visual predators like birds into trying to attack this part of the insect. Which is an expendable part of the wing. Sometimes you'll see butterflies like this with a little beak-shaped chunk missing from that part of the wing, which is indirect evidence, at least, that it works. Because this, if the bird were to attack the head end, which is usually what they go for, that would kill the butterfly. But if it just takes out a chunk of the wing here, the butterfly can get away without too much damage. So that's just an interesting little evolutionary ploy that we see. Here's also some false eye spots of a click beetle. This is a fairly large beetle. You might see this sometimes in your yard. the false eye spots on insects like this are believed to just be kind of a deterrent to visual predators, although in this particular case it's really not studied what exactly the function of that is. But it certainly makes for an interesting looking creature, and I always enjoy seeing these kinds of insects with their strange eye spots and other costumes. Here's a butterfly you might have seen in your yard, the red-spotted purple butterfly. It has an interesting costume, not only because it's pretty, you know, this blue coloration on the hind wings is an enjoyable thing to see. It's just not a common color that you see in nature. But what's even more interesting about this costume is that it's mimicking another butterfly that is unpalatable to predators. So this is mimicking a butterfly called the pipevine swallowtail butterfly, which is known to be quite noxious because it feeds on pipevine. Doesn't really occur around here so much, but a little bit to the south of us, we're kind of right on the edge of that butterfly's range, but to the south of us, where there's Dutchman's pipe, those butterflies feed on that as caterpillars. They sequester or store the toxins from those plants in their bodies, and then the adult butterflies carry that, just like monarch butterflies do with milkweeds and the cardiac glycosides from milkweeds. So this butterfly is a mimic of the pipevine swallowtail butterfly, even though if you look at it closely, it doesn't look all that much like it. But when it's flying around, and even from a distance, its colors are similar enough that it's just, you know, if you were a bird trying to make a decision about what to try to eat, you just might not want to take that risk. What's also especially interesting about this butterfly is it's very closely related to the viceroy butterfly, which looks totally different. It mimics the monarch, which you might know about that. So orange and black, very closely related, but it mimics a totally different distasteful model, the monarch. So that's another just fun aspect to this. This is the caterpillar of the red-spotted purple butterfly, which also has its own strange and somewhat disgusting costume. It looks like a bird dropping. There are some other caterpillars and even some adult moths that look like bird droppings. So this is another way to try to avoid being eaten. No bird wants to eat its own bird dropping, so these turd mimics can do pretty well to avoid being eaten. These feed on cherry trees, black cherry usually. And some other kinds of plants too, but mainly that around here. And so the costumes that these caterpillars have matter for bird predation. I've done some research in my lab of the caterpillars in forests in Connecticut, showing that those kinds of costumes, whether they are mimicking something distasteful or presenting some other kind of warning signal, the birds really do avoid those caterpillars. Similarly, the caterpillars that are very well camouflaged, that look really a lot like the plants they live on and eat, also get quite a bit of protection from birds that way. So it's usually these kind of green, wormy things that you see that get eaten the most by birds. So good to have, you know, the chickadees and the titmice and, you know, the other birds in your yard, because they're also helping take care of those pests. All right, I'm going to finish with a dramatic story that really doesn't have much to do with your garden, but it's a bit of my research that I just want to tell you about because it's fun. And this is the story of the self-medicating caterpillar. So you might recognize this from Eric Carle's famous book, The Very Hungry Caterpillar. And here, my twist on this story is that not only is the caterpillar hungry, but it actually is after certain kinds of chemicals that will provide medicine for it. This is the caterpillar in question. It's It has a scientific name of Gramia incorrupta. It has a common name of the honorable woolly bear caterpillar, although this is really not a very well-known caterpillar species at all. Woolly bears, though, you might know of because we have the banded woolly bear around here, that one that's black with the orange band. And usually you'll see it in the late summer and early fall crossing roads and things like that. It's related. These woolly bears are all part of the same family of moths called the tiger moths. They're very diverse. There are about 11,000 species known. Most of them are living in the tropics. But in the temperate zone, we have these woolly bears. And in different parts of the United States, we have different species. This one happens to be pretty common down in southern Arizona, where I was doing my graduate work at the University of Arizona. And anyway, it feeds on a lot of different kinds of plants, just like our banded woolly bears around here. Feed on a lot of low-growing plants and turns into this tiger moth, which is very beautiful. And these are the eggs of that moth. They lay these eggs and, you know, hundreds and hundreds of eggs, and they turn into these caterpillars, and they live out in grasslands and places like that. This is what the habitat kind of looks like out in these places, and they just feed on lots of different kinds of plants out here in these grasslands, and you can see one here. The self-medication story is that when these caterpillars are feeding, they are under threat of attack by tachinid flies that I told you about before, these parasitoids. And they will lay eggs on the caterpillars, and those fly larvae will get inside and try to kill and eat the caterpillar. And what the caterpillar can do is eat medicinal plants, such as these little low-growing plants here. And they can actually store the chemicals, the toxins from those plants in their bodies, and they can kill those parasitoids inside them. And our research has shown that, you know, it's either some of these parasitic flies and wasps that will eat the caterpillars. And our research has shown that when these caterpillars get attacked by these tachinid flies, they actually will change their feeding behavior to increase their ingestion of toxic alkaloids from certain plants like, whoops, sorry about that. Didn't mean to do that. Let's go back. Like this this shrub here, this is Senecio longilobus. And it has these alkaloids in its leaves, and this caterpillar, which has a fly egg on it, is feeding on this plant, and it will have a good chance of surviving this attack because of its self-medication behavior. So that's my little research story. It's kind of a fun thing. I mean, who knows what other kinds of dramatic stories are happening in your garden, but surely there are many, and it's pretty fun to look for them and get to know the insects in your garden before you just stomp on them or spray them or swat them. And so I just hope that even if, you know, you decide you really don't like insects and you just want to get rid of them, at least I've given you maybe a little bit of pause to think about what else might be going on there, and it can be a lot of fun to look at them. So I'll stop there, and I'm happy to take any questions, and thanks a lot for your attention. Yes.
Do you know what kind of insect strips the hibiscus leaves? Anybody? I mean, there's some kind of little thing that can just take a leaf and just a little silk worm.
I don't know. It's a worm.
Oh, yeah, I know what that is. It's a soft worm.
What good are they?
Well, they just eat them. And so you have to, you know, because they get them on roses too, soft flies. Mm-hmm.
They just really.
Yeah. So they're like caterpillars, but they're actually more closely related to wasps and bees, but they look like caterpillars. But yeah, they do a lot of damage, and really, I mean, the only way I know to get rid of them is just pick them off, you know. And So,
they're little. Aren't they on the underside of the leaf? I think they go on the
underside. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I'm not really familiar with the ones on hibiscus, but most sawflies, and sometimes they're in big groups. You know, they'll just together. They'll just kind of take down, you know, a whole part of a plant or something like that. But you might, others in here might know better ways to control them than I do. But yeah, sawflies.
What else can we do for the monarch butterflies other than let milkweed grow?
Yeah, well, that's, I think, the best thing, you know, to just try to plant milkweed, or if you have, you know, areas near your yard that, you know, they're just kind of weedy areas or whatever, just, you know, don't get rid of the milkweed. So, yeah, the monarchs are really facing a big problem, especially in the Midwest, because they've really killed a lot of milkweed plants with, you know, it's just so easy now for them to spray herbicides, Roundup in particular, and they've genetically modified crop plants to be resistant to Roundup. So they just use widespread herbicide application, which pretty much kills everything but the crop plants that are resistant, and that has really been a major blow for monarchs. So, you know, in general, I mean, I'm someone who, I mean, I like to garden myself, and I've always been someone who, in my gardening, I just like to have a diversity of plants, fair number of native plants and things like that. And I've always found that if you get a little ecosystem going, you generally get pretty decent pest control from just the various predators in that ecosystem. Occasionally, you know, you have to resort to tactics like spraying or, you know, other things to get rid of pests, but it's usually more in you know, if you don't really have, if you're not really creating good habitat for the birds and the predatory insects, that you tend to have more pest problems, in my experience. I'm always one to just, I promote biodiversity generally, and when it comes to gardens, I mean, it's also my aesthetic tastes tend to lean more toward a little bit of a wild sort of English garden type. You know, that tends to create a lot of good habitat. But yeah, the monarchs. Save the monarchs. They've had some rough years.
Yeah. You had mentioned that the aphids and the transmission of a virus.
Yeah.
And the virus to the plant. But then you also mentioned that the ants, the waste product of the aphids. Mm-hmm. Is that a whole kind of virus transmittal system going on?
No, the virus doesn't get transmitted in the honeydew that the aphids excrete and that the ants then drink. It just stays within the aphid. Unless the aphid is feeding on a plant, that's when the virus can get out into another plant. And it's also when an aphid can pick up a virus from another plant. So that's the way that transmission works. But the ants really don't play a part in transmission of the disease. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know exactly what my question here is. It's an observation. Mm-hmm. I find that there are certain insects that will appear out of nowhere, mm-hmm. and in large numbers onto one plant in my garden.
Mm-hmm.
I think one is something that comes to the asparagus. Uh-huh. Now, this asparagus bed is a very old bed, but it's half a mile at least or more away from any other asparagus.
Yeah.
All by itself.
Yeah.
But they'll come, you know, and they'll suddenly be a large number of this one kind of insect that I never, ever see anywhere.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even see them if they didn't settle on the plants.
Yeah.
And I've had it in my flower garden also with something else. And it's so amazing. How do they...
Yeah.
And this is a garden that's in the middle of the woods.
Yeah.
Not close to... anything. How on earth did they find these, and so many of them?
Yeah. So probably what's happening there in those kinds of aggregations like that, and there's probably a pheromone. So this is a chemical that's released into the air, and insects are amazingly good at detecting very small concentrations of pheromones in the air, and they will be attracted to it. And so usually it's a mating signal. So usually when they're in groups like that, there'll also be some mating going on. But these pheromones, sometimes there are aggregation pheromones that aren't related to mating. But usually that's what's going on. And they can, yeah, they'll just, you know, all those insects from all around will just be able to follow that odor. Amazing as it seems, you know, they can track it and follow it and wind up in that same place.
Now, these insects, do you think that they are spend the rest of the time, their life cycle, in the vicinity, and I just don't see them?
They might.
So that they're always there, and then when the plant is in the right stage, then suddenly I get to see them.
Yeah, that happens a lot, because a lot of times, you know, a large part of the life cycle will be spent like underground, for example, and you wouldn't see it. And then, you know, at the right time, they come out, and usually they're, you know, overwintering as pupae or something like that in the soil, and they'll come out and, you know, there they are, you know, and there might be a pheromone involved as well. So they're usually, their life cycles are very well timed to take advantage of the resources they use. And so it's pretty likely that that's part of the story as well. Yeah.
Are they eating your asparagus?
Well, just the stalks. You know, when they've gone to
fertilizer.
So they're
not doing damage that you care about.
Yeah.
Well, that's good. Yeah. Well, that's interesting. Well, take a photo. And.
Well, you know, on the internet now.
Yeah.
The photos there. Because I had this infestation of something on the milkweed, this little hairy thing.
Yeah.
And darned if I didn't find the exact picture of it.
Yep.
I learned that from somebody here who had it on their telephone.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
Take it right with them.
Yeah, it's really, I mean.
I had to go to my desk and put it on the computer.
It's a really good way to figure out what you've got. I mean, sometimes it takes a little bit of hunting just to sort of get in the right ballpark, but once you're close, you usually can kind of figure it out, because someone else has probably seen the same thing and photographed it. So yeah, that's right. I think, you know, it's a great tool to have nowadays, you know, the internet, all kinds of insect pictures that can help with garden pest identification. I like, you know, some of the books that really are more authoritative and give you a lot more information as well. So I still, you know.
But the internet has the advantage of multiple pictures.
That's right. That is.
I had the pupa of a swallowtail. And it was on a brown flower pot. So instead of being green.
Yeah, it was brown.
The darn thing was brown.
Yeah.
And all the pictures, everything I looked at were green except one.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they have different authors.
Yeah.
I finally found one
that matched.
Said they could be brown.
That's right.
And
that's right.
It matches the brown flower pot.
That's right. Now, you're absolutely right. I usually like to use both. You know, the diversity of pictures on the internet, along with a guidebook that really, yeah, it's really nice to use both. So, yeah, that's good. That's good. Yeah, any other questions? All right, well, thanks.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
3. Funding for Simsbury Community Television is provided in part by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.